Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala barakatuh. Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah rabbil alameen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala sharafil anbiya al-mursaleen wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Alhamdulillah. We have discussed about the nature of how our expression of free will in terms of whether we are doing something good or something evil, it will affect our life insofar as whether we succeed in life and then in the hereafter or we fail in life. So each and every one of us has been given the capacity within the framework in which Allah created us and make us His vicegerent on this earth, His Khalifa on this earth, and He give us limited free will to fulfill our role of the completion of this life to be a wonderful human being. Alright? And we have individuals, I've explained to you the case of Mr. A, and then how the case of Mr. B. Miss B, she comes from a very broken up family and yet she succeeds in life, and how in terms of the collective will of this human being, we are the only creature collectively that can shape the destiny of this world. Alright, that means within our limited free will, we have this capacity to make this world a better place or to make this world a terrible place, which is now happening. That means out of our collective human greed in the 21st century, we are destroying this earth. We are doing all kind of things that would finally cause the demise of first the various species on this earth. That means there's a mass extinction of species. Now the sixth mass extinction ever happened. It will cause ecological disaster. It will cause drought and suffering for more than 3 billion human beings in the next 50 to 100 years if we do not care. We will cause the drowning of all major cities in the world because of the melting of the polar ice, all right, the North and South Pole, and the sea level rising, all right, 50 meters and so on. So it is our own hands. And Allah tells us in the Quran, why are you causing destruction? Why are you causing this? It's addressing to all humanity. So as Muslims, we must have this sense of responsibility that no doubt we have science, we have technology, we have everything, but if we rely on science and technology alone, notwithstanding the nature of our existence, this fragility of this dunya, even in a physical sense, then we are all collectively responsible to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Yawmul Akhir. Why we did not stop this ongoing disaster that is going to affect all of us, especially the poor countries like Bangladesh, Sub-Sahara, parts of Asia, Africa, even Europe, and so on. So what we need to do is we must have a will and way forward that is in consonant with the duties of being the vicegerent of God on this earth. So how are we going to do that? So I'm going to give you some ideas, all right? The way forward and the will, we are discussing about our growth model, GROW. Now we are talking about will and way forward. I've given you a couple of videos on will. So if we want to move forward as individual, then remember I told you the four levels: individual, family, society, and global. At that level of expression of our will and free will, we are not concerned what is happening in the next galaxy outside the Milky Way because it is beyond us. That is within the realm of the will of the Absolute, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But because we are representing as the vicegerent of God on this earth, we have the will of affecting ourselves, our family, our society, and globally. Whether it is a physical aspect, the interpersonal aspect, intrapersonal aspect. You go back to our model, we have the four aspects, whether it is physical environment, the interpersonal, intrapersonal environment, and how we nurture our inner speech to shape our personality at the level of spiritual, emotional, mental, and physical self. So, what is important, there are three things that we do that we can shape our way forward positively as individuals. I remember as a life coach, we always tackle individuals first, then we will tackle our family or families, group of families, because there is a tremendous need of coaching, mentoring, and counseling in the ummah, which we are not doing. That's why we have a lot of problems in terms of drug addiction, in terms of breakup of families, in terms of divorce, in terms of social, destructive social behavior, addiction, and everything. Suicide also, there's a lot of suicide now even within the Muslim families. So all these things points to a tremendous need for life coaches. That's why, as I say, we are doing this and giving you some ideas how to go about with it. So the way forward is at every level, at ourselves, starting with ourselves. We cannot try to preach to other people if we ourselves are not trying to correct ourselves. But remember, you need not be a perfect being. There is no perfect being in this dunya except the Prophet, the Prophets of Allah. All of us are in a way having sins, having shortcomings, having broken ideals and so on. But that's normal, all right? But we try to first have a sense of purpose and meaning in life, which I have repeated many, many times. That if we just depend on ourselves on the material things in which the whole mass media, the whole multinational companies, the whole world is moving towards consumption, 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 and more consumption, junk food, junk food, junk food, and more junk food, fast food, and all the other things, GMO seeds, all kind of things that just to create more animals that are fattened with antibiotics, you name it, it's all short-term gain for long-term loss because of what? We have no sense of purpose and meaning that transcend profit, that transcend greed, that transcend this physical plane. And I've explained to you, as a life coach, we must first have a sense of purpose, a higher meaning and purpose in life. That's why it's very important in our book. We have a whole chapter on understanding our role as being the Khalifa of Allah or the Vicegerent of God on earth, responsible for ourselves, our family, our immediate society and the world, to whatever level of our expression of our freedom and our free will. Alright, so I have given you a lot of ideas on this. Secondly, once we understand the purpose and meaning in life, we must be fulfilling our responsibilities in life. That means, what are the basic things that we have to fulfill within our existence on this earth? That means we have to fulfill naturally as a physical being. We are living now in a physical realm. As a spiritual being, really living in a physical realm, we have to fulfill our basic physical needs. That means we need food, we need shelter, we need healthcare, we need education, we need amenities, we need transportation, we need all those basic infrastructure to keep us comfortable on this life. That means, if you compare our life even to our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he just have a house where it is barely 10 feet by 10 feet. That is his home, all right? And when he says his night prayer, the legs of Sayyidina Aisha was bumping into him when he was in his sujood. Imagine how small. Yet they live a wonderful, happy, prosperous, in the sense, holistic life. Or if you look at all the great imams and all that, they fulfill that. That means even if you look at all the great kings of the past, they do not have our amenities. We have air conditioning, we have cars, we have aeroplanes, we have even personal private jets, you name it and have it. So some are the extreme. Some are just basic amenities as we go along in life. We don't go on horse cart to go to point A to point B. We go in a car or on the tram or whatever, electric car or self-driving car in the future, whatever it is. That is acceptable. But if we go on to the extent that everything is just on the material plane, then we are not fulfilling our responsibilities in life. So we have to infuse in our responsibility the sense of, I've explained many times, the sense of Islam, Iman, Ihsan. What are the responsibilities of Islam, the Rukun Islam, of our prayer, of our fasting, of our zakat, of our hajj, of our faith in Allah? What are our rukun iman? Of believing in Allah, believing in the angels, believing in the prophets, believing in the books, believing in the hereafter, and believing in qada and qadar. And what are our ihsan? Of our realization that whatever we do, Allah is seeing us, and we do as if Allah is seeing us. Even we do not see Allah, Allah is seeing us all the time, and we have the realization of a higher dimension of existence. So we have to do that. So if one, two, as a life coach, first, remember, our level, that means self first, then family, then community, and then the world. Alright? So, do whatever you can, as best as you can. And the third aspect is, Very, very important. There is congruency of belief versus behavior in life. This I will give you in the next video, inshallah, of how we can try to mold ourselves to have congruency. And in psychology, they call it cognitive dissonance. We do not have cognitive dissonance insofar as our existence and our behavior versus our belief, so that we can fulfill our role as a true and sincere servant of Allah, as His Khalifa on this earth, always striving to make ourselves good, help others to be good, and make this world good and pleasing to all Allah's goodly creature on this earth, inshallah.